Now that we have a reasonable idea of what data mining is all about, let's get into a major concept of data mining methods where we're going to evaluate the performance of a data mining technique. The idea here is based on what we call the holdout set, where we're pretending to be deploying our algorithm to new data as if it were the real scenario of deployment. How does this work? Let me remind you that in supervised learning, we have inputs and an output, and we're trying to predict the output of interest from a set of inputs. The question is, what will happen if we use a data set to learn this relationship, and then with this algorithm that learned the relationship, we deploy it to new data? How well will our predictions actually be? And that's the question we're trying to answer before we get to the deployment stage. What do we do? I'll remind you that we have the process of data mining where we start from an objective and with data, and we go through the whole data mining process until the final deployment. There are two stages here where we're going to be using this idea of data partitioning and the holdout set. The partitioning will happen early on when we just have our data. At that step, we're going to take a subset of the data and lock it up in a drawer and not open it until we're done with all the modeling. When we're totally finished with the modeling stage and we have a final model that we're planning to use, we're going to open that secret drawer and try to apply our model to these data that the model has never seen. That will give us an idea of how well our model will work when we deploy on new data in the deployment stage. Now, how do we do this? We have a data set, and in data mining, again, we assume that we're data rich, so we have plenty of data. We're going to take this data set and randomly split it into a bunch of different subsets. One part is going to be called the training data. This is typically the large part of it. And the training data is going to include a random set of records from the entire data set. Then we're going to take another random sample, and that's going to be called the validation data. The validation data is going to help us when we go and tweak our models or compare different models and be able to look at how they operate on new data. Because when we actually use the training data to learn, our model is biased towards the training data. It knows the training data much better than it will know new data. That's the reason that we also have validation data. Finally, again, we might want, when we're finished with tweaking and changing and comparing and we kept using that validation data, we've actually used it in a similar way to using the training data. So now the validation data are also giving us a somewhat biased view of how well our model will be working on completely new data. That's where we have the test data. That is, again, another random sample that we kept on the side. And we've not used this data for any purpose of modeling, not to compare models, not to tweak parameters on models. This is a fresh set of data. We now deploy our final algorithm to this test data, and that will give us an indication of how well the predictive accuracy will be on new data. Based on the performance here, and of course on practical requirements and considerations, we might decide to go and deploy this algorithm to the new scenario, or else we might learn that our algorithm is not sufficiently good. Maybe its predictive power is insufficient, or maybe it's too heavy computationally to run, or maybe some other operational reason that will stop us at this point. But now we're ready to deploy if everything went well. And again, the deployment data will be yet a different set of data from the one that we use to train and evaluate our model. Now, although here all the nuts seem like random samples from the same bucket, that's not usually the scenario that happens in real life. Because when we have a sample of data that we collected for training the data, for evaluating performance, those data are likely to be a little bit different from the scenario where we're deploying our model, at least in terms of time. Those are going to be future data, whereas the data that we're training on are already available to us right now. So the question is, what happens if that future where we're going to deploy really looks very different? How will the model work? And that's a very valid question, and that can be a big serious problem if we don't take it into account. There's an interesting blog post that came recently on Analytics Bridge, where the author talks about a few different data mining issues, and in particular, he talks about one reason that data mining projects fail, and that is poor cross-validation. And let me read this. Poor cross-validation allows bad models to make the cut by overestimating the true lift or performance to be expected in future data, the true accuracy or the true ROI outside the training set. Then he uses a term called cross-validation, and cross-validation is the poor data's world of taking partitions. When I have a very small sample, I can't afford to split it up into multiple random samples because I don't have enough information to train on, to learn the behavior from. And in that case, there's a poor way of doing it. It consists of basically taking 90% or so of the data and treating the other 10% as test, and then putting it back in and taking a different random sample of 90% and keeping a different 10% out, and so on. So what I'm trying to say is that evaluating performance doesn't require a large data set, because there are also techniques for doing the same with smaller samples. With this, I'm going to close, and we will get back to performance evaluation in more detail, but keep in mind that the holdout set is going to be a critical part of performance evaluation.